Goedemorgen dames en heren, geweldig om hier vanmorgen zoveel sportievelingen aan te treffen. Want zoals Herman net al zei, ja, we gaan vandaag surfen samen.
Just like Herman said, we're going to go surfing. Between the first and the second lecture, we have a small pause so we can change. Well, we're actually not going to surf physically, but we're going to surf in the sea of human activity. If I can ask you, who of you was here yesterday? That's quite a few hands. Who of you listened last night or this morning to the radio or talked to somebody, watched television, read a book, or visited a public place? That's not a whole lot of people. But if you did, you have consciously and unconsciously come in contact with a variety of waves or thoughts. What is that actually, a thought? A thought is something we think, and that thing can be born. At the moment, it's being thought somewhere. In English, we use the same word for that as being used to conceive a child or to conceive a thought, which in Dutch we call conception. This thought can increase in strength when we pay a lot of attention to it, and it can decrease in strength and even die when we don't pay attention to it anymore. We see it often in the usage of words. A couple of politicians decided by the end of April to set their disagreements aside and cooperate with each other. One of them called that jumping over your own shadow. And maybe you still remember this. Before we knew it, everybody in The Hague was jumping or not jumping over his own shadow. And also outside of this town, the expression was being used frequently all of a sudden. Now, a few weeks later, this hype has blown over and we're not using these words so often anymore. Sometimes the spread of a thought takes epidemic proportions, as for instance, the euphoria among European young people about the adventure that was awaiting them at the start of the First World War. And afterwards, this seemed absurd. Or what about the Millennium Bug that was supposed to shut down all computers worldwide? Or a more recent example, the Arab Spring, which spread through the Middle East like a wildfire. We're actually always at sea, surrounded by waves of thoughts, some smaller and others bigger. And this explains the use of the subtitle of this lecture, Reading the Waves.
What do we mean with it? Who has looked at surfers at sea? Oh, well, many people.
That's leuk.
Very nice.
De techniek zit altijd vol verrassing, hebben we daarna.
Oh, there is a kind of surprise in the technology.
Nou ja, je ziet ze hier eigenlijk liggen. De golf is nog niet.
You see the waves here in the picture.
Maar wat doen ze nou? Ze liggen op hun plank.
They lie on their board in the water or paddle around, waiting for a suitable wave to surf on. It is important for them to choose the right wave on which they can make a nice and long ride. An experienced surfer has therefore trained himself in distinguishing different waves. And we, who are surrounded by waves of thoughts, what are we doing? Are we floating like a piece of lost driftwood, being carried away by every random wave that passes, or do we consciously choose the waves we find worthwhile? Let us have a closer look at a currently popular thought wave.
En nu mag ik wel gaan drukken. Ja. Misschien een bekend beeld.
Perhaps this is a known image. In the 70s of the last century, inscriptions were discovered in the Maya ruins of Totoguero in Mexico, which describe a calendar. A Maya calendar. According to most scientists, this calendar would start in 3114 before Christ and the 13th and last period would end around December 12, 2012. In 1987, a book was published in which was concluded that this date would mean the end of time. The book became a bestseller. We are approaching the mentioned date, more and more is being published about the subject, and the number of discussions increases. Quite a few people experience increased fear, and some people even sold their houses and everything they own to search for a safe haven somewhere on a mountaintop in South Africa or New Zealand, awaiting the calamity. When we further examine this thought wave, we first see that the idea of the end of time is so-called linear thought. There is an absolute end, and therefore also an absolute beginning. When we solely look at the external side of things, we will quickly start to believe that that's right. What we can't perceive with our senses doesn't exist. And the physical birth of a being should mean the absolute beginning and the dying, the final end. This linear thinking is typical for the Western world and coming from our Western ecclesiastical tradition, in which the view that God created the world out of nothing in 7 days was taken literally, and the apocalypse from the Bible, according to the Church, meant the end of times. We can also see this in our current Western focus on the external side of life, even into science.
In non-Western traditions, the circular thought is generally more common. Every end is a new beginning, like the end of winter means the start of spring. Yesterday, we have already concluded together that growth unfolds in cyclic movements. Periodic movements of beings deriving from the inner force, in which they experience active phases and rest phases. Also, the Mayas, with their knowledge of nature, saw this as well. According to their calculation, we would be in the 13th cycle of 144,000 days since their own mythical birth process. Therefore, it's not a strange idea to assume that they saw the end of this large cycle coincide with the start of another one. For a Maya, a Hindu, or a Buddhist who grew up with the idea that consciousness is the leading force behind each manifestation, this whole 2012 hype will have no meaning. And that these kind of jokes can only be made, therefore, by Western people. In this picture, we can see also that a thought is subjected to cyclic movements, periods of activity, which are being followed by periods of rest. Is this the first time that a part of humanity thinks that the end of time is near? Since the beginning of this era, the end of time has been predicted hundreds of times. The year 2000 was extremely popular, and if this year ends successfully, we can be sure that a new doomsday prediction will arrive quickly.
Finally, we can tell you the latest scoop that archaeologists have very recently found the oldest known Maya calendar in the ruined city Xultung in Guatemala. It is the calendar must have been... Oh, they found this image in a hidden house. The calendar must have been made in the 19th century and consists of hundreds of numbers describing cycles which were important to the Mayas. Their own ceremonial calendar of 260 days, a solar year of 365 days, and the circulation of Mars and Venus, respectively 780 and 584 days. The calculations on this calendar are continuing for another 7,000 years in the future. Astronomer and co-writer of an article on the subject in the coming June issue of National Geographic, Aveni, says, "The Mayas predicted that the world would exist hundreds of years more. We keep searching for the end while they were searching for evidence to prove everything would stay the same." Aveni compares it with the odometer of a car. After 129,999 km just comes 130,000 km. The car is a small step closer to the junkyard, but the Maya calendar just starts again. The hype about the Maya calendar seems to be just a storm in a teacup. In summary, we can note that thoughts are being born and die and usually come back cyclically if we give attention to it. Furthermore, they can increase in strength if sufficient attention is paid to them, even till epidemic proportions.
Now, if we're going to look consciously at waves of thoughts just like a surfer, we can differentiate for ourselves what makes sense and what is nonsense. Subsequently, we can determine for ourselves where we want to get involved and where we don't want to. We can, like we do in the course Thinking Differently, extensively learn how to differentiate the seven different aspects of thinking. Well, this is a these are the surfers that are not only checking the waves, but the waves also contains a surprise, just like some thought waves contain surprises. Well, for some of you, this picture is familiar. The seven aspects of thinking, from going down to up, the physical aspect. When everybody is going to have lunch later on, it's fairly hard not to feel like eating, even if you've taken some sandwiches in the break. One up, the emotional aspects, we often see them, for example, at moments when we feel sorry for somebody, or when we suddenly forget our bad mood at the moment we see some happy friends. One up, we can recognize pranic thought waves in our impulse to do something, even though we haven't thought about it yet, and even though there's no plan. We see this in the organizations of almost every project, but also, for instance, the tendency of Western governments to always want to intervene when something goes wrong. So we also call this vitality. In the middle, at the line, we see desire. Waves of desire we saw at financial organization that promised the world to us, and of course in shopping streets. But we also see desire in numerous volunteers who commit themselves voluntarily as a buddy to people who are seriously ill, who have a life-threatening illness. Desire is a neutral force, which we can focus on our own selfish personal aspects, the first three we've mentioned, or on our higher superpersonal aspects. I is we. Intellectual waves we find when we, for instance, visit a scientific conference, play word feud on our phone, or listen to an analysis on the radio.
The two highest aspects of thinking have a subtle nature and are therefore not so easy to distinguish if we haven't trained ourselves in this. Comprehension or insight, recognizing the relationships, is the sixth level. The seventh aspect of thinking is inspiration. Manifestations of this are rare and can best be described as an experience of unity, like we occasionally might experience when we feel one with nature, or when we are part of a perfectly cooperating unity of people who unselfishly cooperate for a higher cause. We can find a nice example in the work of the Commission of Truth and Reconciliation, as has been established in Chile by the former President Aylwin. Let's see if you can recognize the higher aspects of thinking from his words when he presented the report of the Commission on March the 4th, 1991. Let's look if we can find them. Fellow citizens, tonight I speak to you about a sensitive subject that is still creating a division among the people of Chile, violation of human rights, which have been committed in the recent past. When I was appointed president, I said that this was an open wound in the soul of our nation, and that only reconciliation based on truth and justice could heal such a wound. Having that in mind, I established a National Commission for Truth and Reconciliation and appointed in this people of greed, prestige and moral authority. After 9 months of hard work, the Commission produced a report that was approved unanimously and handed officially to me. Now I come back to my promise and will present this report to the nation in public. The truth about the violation of human rights has long been hidden in our country. While some tried to expose the truth, others kept denying it against all odds. Those who were responsible for the investigation of the violations failed. This explains why so many people, if not the majority, didn't believe what had happened. And the conflicting opinions on this matter were another cause of division and hatred among our people. The report that I will represent to you today will reveal the truth, the bare facts in this report, and the moral authority of the writers, and some of them supported the former regime, invite us all to accept the truth. No one who is in good faith can deny her. I am not saying that this is the official truth. The state doesn't have the right to impose the truth. However, I truly believe in this truth and ask you to accept her and to act accordingly. When this truth, how painful and cruel it may be, will be shared by us, she can help to take away the causes of disagreement and division among the people of Chile. Do you recognize the characteristics, the higher characteristics? Here, the president acts from deeper insight and makes an appeal to the deeper insight of people, our ability to see relations, and even to the highest seventh aspects of thinking in the pursuit of unity by collaboration. To make things a bit more complicated, ways of thoughts are usually not one-dimensional, but a composite. For example, by a prolonged drought in the Sahel in West Africa, the harvest failed, and we know for some time that food shortages will arise. The prices of food are therefore already increasing. Conflicts arise on the one side, but on the other side, there are organizations such as Oxfam NoVib and Save the Children who have been campaigning for a long time now to avert a disaster. The wave of with information that eventually reaches you consists of inspiring thoughts of solidarity with our fellow human beings, insightful thoughts about how this can happen again and again, intellectual thoughts about how to solve this problem as fast as possible, but at the same time also thoughts of personal desire from the ones who are hoping to earn a lot of money on the fundraising and the execution of parts of the material solution.
Now we realize that a thought wave has a sevenfold composite nature. The next important question arises: what is the dominant characteristic of that wave? And how does this characteristic change in time? The original idea of an insurance was to share the risk among a group of people that something would happen to any one of this group. This impersonal characteristic is in many cases replaced by personal gain, as is shown in the case of usurious policies. Meanwhile, in developing countries, after the successful introduction of microcredits, there has grown a need for a safety net for the risks of disablement and death. And we've called this yesterday in the workshops. For some time already, employees of Western insurance companies provide their knowledge and experience free of charge to set up micro-insurance corporations. How will the characteristic of this wave develop? Often, we try to secure the original character by laws and regulations, but ultimately, the development is determined by the thoughts of the people. A beautiful example we see in Bogota, the capital of Colombia, in the 90s of the last century.
May I present you? Antanas Mokkes, mathematician and philosopher. Sorry. He has recently lost his job at the university where young anarchists terrorize the staff and fellow students. Interviews with journalists give Mokkes the reputation to be an exceedingly honest man and an original thinker. Suddenly, he is mentioned as the ideal candidate for becoming the mayor of Bogota. And now you know how such an idea may grow. The idea swells to become an enormous wave. And his name is now mentioned everywhere. In that time, Bogota stands at the number one position by far in Latin American statistics of corruption, road casualties, assassinations, crime, etc. Mokus understands the causes of this downward spiral and invents playful methods to handle this. To start with, he realizes that the city is highly polluted because no one gives a good example, especially the administrators, those who should be the top of the hierarchy. Fail to do that. So, he puts on a Superman suit and starts to collect garbage from the streets in person.
Staat hem goed, hè?
Well, it's beautiful, hè?
Hij verzamelt een stadsbestuur.
The city administration is assembled. People, the smartest people of the country. People who had never been city administrator before, but were chosen because they were uncorruptible. The traffic is very unsafe because no one keeps to the rules, and 80% of the traffic police is spoiled by corruption. Mokus fires 10,000 corrupt traffic policemen and replaces them by people who are trained by memes players to regulate the traffic with a wide-made face and a smile. That's about this.
Mokus
knows that for a Colombian citizen, there is one thing even worse than paying a fine: to be made a fool by a meme player. So they start obeying the rules and quickly realize that they themselves are the originators of the chaos in the traffic. Gradually, the order is restored.
After having been invited three times for a congress on reducing car theft, while nobody seemed willing to talk about the 70 murders that occur each weekend, he comes to the conclusion that presumably there is a taboo on this subject. One of the favorite mantras of Mokus is, education makes everything possible. He puts the idea into practice. He teaches young people to develop self-respect, which is the first condition in order to be able to respect other people. Children and parents, policemen and criminals are trained and educated to solve problems without violence. And he invites all parties involved, including the organized crime, to a round table talk in order to find solutions for the violence that dominated the city for such a long time. Although Mokus was taunted by traditional politicians and other powerful people, his unorthodox methods proved to influence the thinking of the people in such a way that the downward spiral is stopped. In the beginning of the 21st century, the metamorphosis of Bogota and its millions of inhabitants is complete, and the city has achieved a respectful position in the statistics. His methods are also being used in other countries nowadays. All this is not so strange if we realize that our acting starts in our thinking. Mokus read the waves around him and decided to focus on the higher aspects of thinking, the intellect and the power of insight. By helping the citizens of Bogota to look differently and think differently, their acts changed. By maintaining this policy in a principled way, other habits developed and finally changed the character of the complete city. Mokus was a mayor and an intellectual, but what can you and I do with this knowledge?
First, you have made the conscious choice to come to this conference, so you know you are surrounded by thought waves of a certain nature. Of course, you could also have chosen to go shopping or bowling, or to go to the city in this beautiful weather. In that case, you were probably surrounded by thoughts of a different nature. To be able to tune ourselves to certain thoughts, there is no need at all to change places physically. We can choose each moment of the day to become angry again at a neighbor who turned on his music so long and so loudly the day before. Or to start thinking about the delicious fresh chocolate cake. But of course we can also think again about that inspiring idea of the unity of existence that we picked up yesterday from the lecture on the ocean, or meditating on what we could contribute to the prevention of hunger. We may compare our thinking faculty to a radio with buttons that enable us to attune the frequency. If we are not pressing the buttons, our radio will probably transmit the frequency to which we are used. To tune our radio consciously to a higher frequency will become easier if we train ourselves to do that. And exactly that happened by the education that the citizens of Bogota received. Of course, our radio is not only a receiver, but also a broadcaster or transmitter. We often attract people with the same bent of mind and feel attracted to environments in which people occupy themselves with the same things as we do. If we step out of bed with a bad mood, we are much more likely to get angry with someone than when we are well-balanced or serene. The thoughts which we surround ourselves are attracted by our own thinking.
If we attune our thinking mainly to our lower, more selfish aspects, we often tend to adapt ourselves to a group in order to get our thoughts fulfilled. If we are not alert, the result is something that we may call mental inbreeding. The managers of the Polaroid company, for instance, surrounded themselves mainly with people, and thus with thoughts, that focused exclusively on analog instant photography. The quick growth of digital photography was a danger for their false feeling of safety and was kept outside. And that's why they went bankrupt in 2001 for the first time. Therefore, independent thinking, independent investigation of what happens around us in the world is extremely important. That this way of approaching our society is not yet very common will be clear. Yet, there are some bright spots. In the city of Hoorn, in the Netherlands, one recognized that when a former prison coming back into society meets everywhere rejection and feels like a paria, he consequently will act like one. In 2006, therefore, the project Aftercare Former Prisoners was launched. Based on the opposite idea, a former prisoner that is stimulated to think of himself as a valuable human being and gets a real new chance in society will probably act according to that idea. Well, the recidivism was only 20%, much lower than the natural average of 70%. Just as we choose or have chosen for the thoughts with which we surround ourselves, in the same way, one could say that we have chosen for the time and the place in which we live. For theosophy teaches us that the attraction that we build up towards certain thought characteristics and the corresponding groups of persons draws us again to these persons and characteristics when we reincarnate, return in the flesh. This we sometimes call the twin doctrine of reincarnation and karma.
As we have heard yesterday, there are always cycles within cycles. For instance, cycles of human lives within the longer cycles of the embodiment of this planet. So let us finally look to the present condition on sea, the characteristic of the period in which we live now. In general, we may state that one cycle is composed of four different kinds of ages, four yugas. And yuga is Sanskrit for age. Satya yuga, well, you know. Looking to the length of time, you see that the yugas show the proportion 4, 3, 2, to 1. In each yuga, a comparable amount of activity happens. So, in Satya Yuga, this takes thus 4 times longer than in Kali Yuga. If we compare this with sea waves, you get schematically this picture. If you start surfing on the upper wave, you may imagine that this will be a rather quiet and relaxed activity. For that reason, Satya Yuga may be translated as the Golden Age.
Kali Yuga,
the Kali Yuga or Iron Age is quite another story. Cause and effect follow each other rapidly. We are all confronted very rapidly with the effects of our thoughts and acts. You may recognize this also in human life. Most of us recognize a certain period in our life when everything seemed to go on steadily and quietly, and another period when we had to take a series of fundamental decisions under great time pressure.
Now you probably wonder in which yuga we live now, but in fact you already know the answer. The moment of Krishna's death, more than 5,000 years ago, was the starting point of the Kali Yuga, of the planetary class of which you and I are a part. It is easy to see this because everything around us changes fast, very fast. Technological developments and all kind of thought waves follow each other at great pace. There is an enormous lot going on today. I say planetary class, for just as some of you may be in a period of acceleration and other people in a very calm period. The different parts or small classes of the human population of this earth are in different cyclical phases. The great pace and speedy developments that we experience are probably passing by the inhabitants of a little village in a remote region. In that case, they are in another yuga. If we compare the yugas to the seasons, the light of the spiritual sun is obviously dimmed. Selfishness rules supreme, and the speed of the development is accompanied with much competition and conflict. Why is this important for us to know? On one hand, we may realize that this is a period full of selfish waves that may quickly come to us. On the other hand, if we make the right choices, this period gives us the opportunities to start positive, quickly growing developments and to grow spiritually. In the Chinese character for the word crisis, that seems very appropriate for this age, we recognize the same picture. The upper part of the picture means danger, the lower part chance.
As we have already discovered yesterday, in the workshop Do We Determine the Time or Does the Time Determine Us? We are in this period and this place as a result of our own attraction. While, on the other hand, we determine the character of this period by our own thoughts and acts. In the next lectures, we shall look to the possibility to ride them. What did we tell you? We are continuously surrounded by thoughts which we broadcast and attract. Thoughts are cycles. We may distinguish seven aspects of thinking. We may learn to focus our thinking. A trained power of discernment is the basis of sustainable changes. We live in Kali Yuga, a period in which cause and effect follow one another quickly. By thinking consciously, you decide whether this period is a period of chances or of threats.
Now,
this wave,
met de volgende spreker. Graag uw vragen.
Your questions, please.
Mevrouw. Begin jij? Als u even wacht, komt er een microfoon uw kant op.
Waiting for the microphone. Yesterday we looked at a few pictures in which we saw the rounds. How do these eras that you just mentioned, the yugas, how do they stay towards these rounds? Well, to give you a short answer, in every round, it is subparted in these yugas. And you can see these yugas even in one human's life. So all the aspects keep coming back. With a distinguishment that you for yourself can decide which yuga you want in your life. If you decide to lay on your couch all day with the feet up, and look at some game programs, then is a very quiet wave you exist yourself on. But you could also decide to spend your time on more spiritual cases. When we look at Nelson Mandela, who is still very, very active at 92 years old, we can see he's in a more active yuga.
You can attune your radio and your thoughts on the chocolate cake, on the neighbor, on the ocean. You can also choose not putting on your radio. What is silence in this story? To get your thoughts to silence, to quietness. Well, the principle of theosophy, of the Theosophical Society, is that we humans are thinkers, manas, and the aim of this period is to train our thinking. It is, of course, very healthy to quiet your thoughts, but if we do not train in this wenteltrap, we will stay at the same point. Oh, you wish to hear something else. So what do you wish to hear then? Is there something else possible besides the thinking? What are you looking for then? Yeah, she thinks about by meditation you can quiet the thoughts. There is some truth in it. You see the quick waves of Kali Yuga and all the noises around us. Well, it may be profitable to quiet it, but that is also needed to get the step to analyze what is going on and what are the causes. Yeah, Herman, may I add, everything put down to zero is impossible. What you can do is to change your focus on another point, to other levels where the waves are more quiet, especially the higher characteristics. You don't solve the real problems by staying emotional, but you should try to get a kind of distance. Inspired by Herman, I may add, the theosophical perspective of meditation is to direct your thoughts on the higher thoughts, and then you will experience the quietness. If you form an image of unity, or what is infinity, then you will experience the same.
Any more questions? Yesterday we talked about sleep and activity. Isn't that the same as that lady just said? Yeah, that's a very good question. Let me go back to this slide. We just came to the conclusion together that we decide for ourselves in which period we stay. So if we decide to stay in a resting phase, then we decide that we are in a Satya Yuga. So that's your own choice. I'm not saying that this life is sleeping, but there are certain times of rest and certain activities. Those alternate. Those alternate with each other. Okay, if it's correct, you slept today, you slept last night, and now you're awake, and you take a holiday after a period that you've been really busy, so you just plan those periods in your life. But as long as you're aware of that, you can choose how long these periods are and when they take place. Is that okay? You are today at this symposium, and I hope for you that this is a period of high activity.
Als het goed is, slapen we daar ook weer goed op vanavond.
Dus and if things are good, we also sleep very good on this.
How do you keep the energy when you try to attune to a certain frequency? Who do you keep that frequency when my thoughts are so jumping? I think about the children with ADHD, activity disorder. I know as a mother, it is important to keep your own energy higher than of your children, so that you can stimulate your kinder to children to get them from their negativity. I have children who are a little bit negative, and to get them out of the negativity, that's not so easy. Well, that's not so easy, especially not for children. What do you mean? Well, these children of me cannot focus so much their thoughts, but I try to direct them and also explain them. Look what you are doing. You are doing this in a negative way. Well, partly you are already explaining and giving them insight so that they will be able to learn that later on. There are many other parents in the room which have already tried to learn that to the children. And in the pause, you can see a pause film where you can see the 7 aspects of thinking made by children. So it is possible to explain it to children. The important is your surroundings. What are the teachers and their friends focusing on? So are they good models? When you think about Antanas Mokus in Bogota, when the administrators do not give the good example, what would the people do? That would not work. So the top of the hierarchy would be the first to give the model. And not only with thinking, but also by thinking. And finally, a very important point of becoming wiser is training of your concentration. And that is for children with activity disorder, it's very difficult. The first time that I came to a lecture, I had probably only heard 5% because my thoughts were jumping all sides. But you will also experience it when you do it oftener, then you take away even more and more and more. So children may learn this too. Is this an answer? The training? I remark a kind of effect. Well, if you have the, if you are the good example, you will see. Everything starts with that.
The lady in the black shirt, you were first. After what the lady said, of course you should always be the right example to your kids, but this doesn't mean that the kids are ready to follow that example, because you can have 2 kids which are completely different and in their behavior and their thoughts, and you can be the example, but it doesn't mean that it's enough for one of the 2 kids that they're ready, that they can follow this. So I think in some way or some level you have to adapt to that level and try to guide them as a parent, and it doesn't mean that you're not like not the right example, but sometimes it's also the level of spirituality in the kid that it's different. You're not the only one who influences the kids. 2 kids can have very different characters, but they all have 7 aspects in their thinking, in their character. This is what we try to do, and we call this education, bringing out what is already in there, helping them with that. And that's a characteristic that is always taking place. In the meantime, we can look at what are we looking at, what needs to be brought out. What do we focus on? Like trying to share your toys with other kids.
Ja, hier. En daarna komen we bij u, mevrouw. Meneer.
We know. We know all.
Dat is aardig. Gisteren was er iemand die u hielp met de microfoon. En nu krijgt u hulp van uw buurvrouw. We werken allemaal samen vandaag.
We all work together this day. We all know that humanity is already million years existing. And you said about Krishna 5,000 years ago.
De laatste verschijning van Krishna.
It was probably the last verschijning, appearance of Krishna. That proves that during those million years that we human beings exist, that the cycle is repeating itself. Those four ages, the four yugas, are not only going on one time, but each time come back. But may I ask, who is Krishna? Krishna has come as an embodiment of the yuga, and he comes when the cruelty is so strong in the world, then he appears. And he is trying to restore that. So that's the way that Krishna came at that time when there was a cruel rainer. And he does each time. He comes back. And then the circle comes back to Kali Yuga. Well, Bahrein says that the next speaker will say about this. Herman? About Krishna. We know him the best from the Bhagavad Gita. It's the higher nature which helps the lower human being with his choices. Arjuna must fight in the mental field, of course, and to see the karmic consequences of his own acts. So it's clear that gives personal suffering. But that will not say that Krishna is the cause of suffering and violence. No, he shows us the karmic consequences and what is the path that we have to go. But we shall have to, verwerken. Our own causes to restore. We have to restore our own causes, and that may be painful.
Om misschien even toe te voegen, aardig. Ik weet niet of het is opgevallen, maar dat ontstaan van de.
If you know the mythe of the Mayas, and that is in the same moment when Krishna died. So the calendar started about 5,000 years ago. So 3,100 years ago before our date is a very important. Also the Chinese calendar started then. They have cycles of 60 years and they have always said it goes on and goes on. And it repeats itself, the 60 years. And we can see in this history, 5,000 years ago, there were really an important few cycles starting. Ah, there was another question. Is that true?
Okay, we have a few more minutes. I will keep it short. I would like to aspect of the aspect with the kids. I think they are able to follow the example. I followed a talk in school where we were talking about the kids. And the kids came with very nice names and good examples. And they show that they can think in a certain way. And I think if you want to train them, that you just have to trigger those certain aspects, because they recognize it straight away. Can you give me one example for what you see, for what you saw last year? They were able to think according to those aspects, and when you were talking with them, they came with answers, and you wonder where does it come from, and it is there, it's already in there, but you just have to trigger it. Thank you so much for this wonderful addition.
Iedereen tevreden?
Is everybody satisfied?
Ja, bent u klaar voor...
Are you ready?
Oh, kijk eens. Ze wil nog even bevestigen dat dat ook inderdaad gebeurt.
Ah, dat is leuk, wat leuk, ja!
She just wants to...
Misschien wel aardig voor u om te weten. We hebben dus een,
maybe good for you to know that we have a kids group run by Theosophical parents who are doing the course Thinking Differently in the in like plays and very inspiring activities. Nice when you're a little bit older. And just to show that it's possible to bring these aspects in kids to develop them.
Op inspelen.